Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the seventh meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2022. The first item on our agenda is for committee members to agree or not to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The second item of business is for the committee to agree or not to take our next meeting on Thursday the 9th of March in private. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Thank you. And the principal item of business that we have this morning is agenda item 3, which is consideration of the 2021-22 audit of the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland report. It's a section 22 report. And can I welcome our witnesses this morning, the Auditor General, Stephen Boyle. Sitting alongside the Auditor General is Pat Kenny, who's a director Audit and Assurance at Deloitte, and also Senior Manager from Audit Scotland, Richard Robinson. You're all very welcome. We've obviously got quite a number of questions to put to you about the report we're considering this morning. But before we do that, Auditor General, could I invite you to make an opening statement?
Many thanks, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I am presenting this report on the 21-22 audit of the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life in Scotland under Section 22 of the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Act 2000. Convener, the Commissioner's Office plays a vital role in upholding public trust in ethical standards in public life through investigations into the conduct of MSPs, local authority councillors, lobbyists and members of public boards. It also oversees the appointment process to public authorities. Last year, I reported significant concerns about the operation of the Commissioner's Office. Since then, the Commissioner's Office has worked hard to address serious failings, and it's clear that improvements have been made. But the dual task of meeting core business demands alongside addressing all of the concerns identified during 2020-21 means that pressure on the Commissioner's Office will continue. The Commissioner's Office has now introduced some of the fundamentals of governance that every public body needs to have to operate effectively. It has also re-engaged with its key stakeholders, including the Audit Advisory Board and the Scottish Parliamentary Corporate Body, and it reports full compliance with the ongoing statutory directions that were issued by the Standards Commission for Scotland. But capacity concerns to manage its workload continued during 21-22. I note that in October 2022, the Parliamentary Corporate Body supported the Commissioner's Office request for additional funding to help address some of the matters identified in the previous year. The complaints backlog remains high. The Commissioner's Office is currently reporting on its website that it will take up to 8 months to investigate an initial assessment of a complaint. While additional recruitment will help, it will take time to address outstanding complaints, and failure to process complaints in a timely way may continue to affect public confidence in the process, both for individuals making complaints and for those subject of one. A previously agreed restructuring exercise was reversed in the year, meaning that anticipated savings of around £450,000 will not now be realised. Given the pressures to address the backlog, alongside the reversal of intended cost-saving restructuring, a focus on maintaining financial sustainability over the medium and longer term is needed in the Commissioner's Office. Convener, I'll continue to monitor progress and report publicly in future as necessary. Richard, Pat and myself will do our utmost to answer your questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. I think that was a very useful laying out of some of the principal points that are contained in the report and some of the areas that we're, I think, keen to probe a bit more deeply into. And I'm going to begin by inviting Willie Coffey to put some opening questions to you. Willie.
Thanks very much again, Convener. Good morning, Auditor General. I wonder if we could start at the recommendations themselves. The Section 22 contained a number of recommendations, 22 in fact. And I think your report's telling us that 10 are complete. And from my reading of it, another 10 are still in progress, but others may not be being pursued. I wonder if you could give us a little summary, please, of progress with the recommendations and your view about whether the satisfactory progress has been made in carrying out the recommendations that have been made.
Yeah, good morning, Mr. Coffey. I'm happy to start on that, and I'll bring Pat in as well, whose audit was identified the recommendations and they're set out in detail the progress that Deloitte have judged that has been made in Pat's annual audit report. At a summary level, 22 recommendations were made. 10 of those have now been implemented. 10 are work in progress. 2 deemed no longer relevant. The 2 broadly is in respect of the anticipated savings that I mentioned in my opening remarks of the 450,000, that given that that's now been reversed, not applicable to track progress against those. At a high level, Mr. Coffey, the progress refers to establishing some of the fundamentals that we've spoken about in terms of governance with the committee in previous years, such as an internal audit function, business plan, training for staff, and a risk register that we set out in some of that detail at paragraph 10 to the report. Work still to be done is in regard of some of the staffing and workforce plans. I may come back to that in a second if I may say a bit more about that. And then other aspects of how the Commissioner's Office is functioning, such as the progress that they're making in terms of the investigations manual, which is now in draft, and then progress alongside that about some of the engagement with key stakeholders. Progress, but still some remaining work to be done. If I may say one additional word about workforce. At the time this was drawn in terms of progress against the recommendations, the Commissioner's Office has undertaken a significant workforce planning exercise that was part of, it's led to the judgments and the submission to the Parliamentary Corporate Body for additional resource for staffing to secure the effective running of the organisation in their judgment, together with addressing the backlog. In totality, Mr. Coffey, I think we'd say progress has undoubtedly happened in the past 12 months. If I'm going to pause, I'll bring Pat in. I'm sure he'll want to give a bit more flavour to that.
Yeah, thanks, Auditor General. Yes, there's been ongoing progress. I think some of the key things that were outstanding, for example, was the full investigation manual. And that is now complete. There was and will be implemented from this month. And that was subject to very wide ranging consultation with the Standards Commission, with local authorities, and benchmarked against other investigatory bodies in the UK. So I think, and it's also been subject to an internal audit review. So that is now ready to launch. The other major recommendation that was outstanding was on medium-term financial planning. And again, progress since the Section 22 report on that, that is ready to go, that will be ready to go, I understand, from this month as well. They're also making good progress on recruitment of the additional personnel that was approved by the Parliament Corporate Body. They've recruited individuals into the investigatory team and to corporate services. They've still got progress to recruit in terms of the public appointments team. But I think in terms of the outstanding recommendations, Mr. Coffey, based on what I've seen, there is steady progress ongoing. And I think the new auditor in place will assess again that during the course of the next year's audit. But since the Section 22 report, I'm seeing good progress on the outstanding recommendations.
Other colleagues will probably pick up on the staffing issue and the £450,000 when they ask their questions. But do you get the sense that the progress that has been made is actually addressing the weaknesses that were identified? Are you confident and assured that what you've been seeing is doing what it has to do to get the organisation back into a good state, let's say?
I don't think none of us should underestimate the scale of progress that was required based on last year's report. You know, there were some real fundamentals that were absent from the Commissioner's Office. You know, we've talked about some of the aspects of governance, not having an internal audit function, an audit advisory board, the breakdown of relationships that we talked about too, alongside the backlog in cases. So progress has undoubtedly been made, but there are still significant challenges to be resolved, notably the backlog, the concerns about what that might mean for public trust in the process. What it's done is given them a platform to, with the much stronger prospects of success. The only word I would just kind of bring to the committee's attention is that this has taken a lot of the organisation over the past 12 months. They themselves have described it as rebuilding mid-flight to both deliver their statutory functions whilst addressing very substantial audit recommendations. They've done well. They've still got some work to do.
Bailey, will you revisit in a period of time just to continue to check progress? Yes. Is this the last we might hear?
I'll keep an open mind on that one, if I may. Mm-hmm. Pat and his colleagues at Deloitte have now finished their audit appointment on the Commissioner's office. A new team has been appointed, and that's as part of the audit rotation arrangements. There's always that opportunity when a new auditor engages an organisation that they'll bring a fresh perspective, and I'll await their conclusions and judgments as we move into the autumn. Upon consideration of that, Mr. Coffey, I'll take a view as to whether there's any public reporting required.
Would anyone share with us if there's 10 recommendations that are still in progress have by and large been completed? Would anyone share that with us, do you think?
What I'll do, Mr. Coffey, convener, is that I'll follow the fairly established process that I now have with the committee. If I decide not to do a Section 22 report on the back of having done one in a previous year on a public body, I will write to the committee with the details of that and set out some of the progress and my rationale for why I've decided either to report or not to. So I'll continue to do that.
Okay. Many thanks. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, because I think this action plan of 22 recommendations and the charting of its progress that's contained in the wider audit report, I think is very useful for us and is the kind of thing that gives us a kind of factual presentation of how well things are going and where there are issues. And we will come to some of the issues which we think are still outstanding that are identified in that action plan. But I'm going to turn to the Deputy Convener, Sharon Dowie. Sharon.
Thank you. Good morning. In paragraph 15, the auditor has reported that issues remain where the SPCB and the Commissioner's Office need to work together to address some specific governance issues identified. Could you tell us more about the issues?
Yeah. Good morning, Deputy Convener. I'm happy to kick off on that one, and I'll bring Pat and Richard in to say a bit more too. We've mentioned in already the scale of challenge that existed with the parliamentary corporate body's relationship with the Commissioner's Office. There's been engagement over the course of this year, firstly in terms of the financial position of the Commissioner's Office through a new budget request, subsequently approved by the Parliament for investment in the organisation. There's also been wider consideration, indeed, this committee's own engagement with the parliamentary corporate body through evidence session and then subsequent correspondence between the committee and the presiding officer, and indeed suggestions about wider oversight arrangements between the Parliament and its commissioners. From what we've seen, and you know, it's clearly a matter for the Parliament to determine what is most appropriate, is that that represents progress that strikes the right balance between operational independence for its commissioners, but ultimately a clearer and more effective channel for accountability and oversight. So I would say that there are, again, signs of progress on that front too. As ever, these will be tested in rare occasions, and you know, where there are stress on relationships and so forth. We're not in that situation at the moment. But nonetheless, we've seen signs of progress that kind of set out the relationship between the Commissioner's Office and the parliamentary corporate body. Again, I'll turn to colleagues for a moment, if I may, if there's anything they want to add about the wider governance and relationship. Richard.
Pat, may I want to add to this as well? There's probably a couple of dimensions which come through for the audit report. And one is, if we look to last year's, was around breakdown in engagement between and key relationships. So some of the governance is around, well, and I think you had evidence from the SPCB last year around this, had you formalised the requirements for engagement to improve that element of governance. The other one is just around those internal checks and balances, if you will. So mentioned within the auditor's report is about talking to the SPCB about identifying reporting routes in cases in which the threshold for protected disclosures is not met. Effectively, are they comfortable that if there were concerns around the operation of the office internally, there would be clear reporting routes for them to take them out if the normal whistleblowing thresholds are not met? I think those are the two, Patrick.
Yeah, those routes of emphasis in terms of where staff can go if they have concerns about the office holder in the future have been re-emphasised within the organisation. For example, there's a route to go to Audit Scotland for certain concerns, and that's been emphasised. The accountable officer of ethical standards can also go to the accountable officer of the Parliament corporate body. And there's also the Audit Advisory Board chair. That in terms of concerns, that has been clarified in terms of a reporting route to that chair if there are any concerns within the organisation. So I think there's definitely, again, has been progress in that respect. And I think that was a major root cause of the previous governance failure. So it was very important to rectify that. But again, that's something that I wouldn't say that if I was continuing on in the audit role, I would be keeping a very close eye on that to make sure that beds in and is implemented effectively, because it's a key thing that has to get put right going forward. So there's certainly been progress been made in that respect, but very important that continues to be looked at by the audit function going forward.
Thanks. So we will continue to be updated on that issue.
Yeah, really just to reiterate my comments, Mr. Coffey, there is an audit will happen, as it will always do this year. An incoming auditor will assess progress against previous audit recommendations, whether it's been made by their organisation or otherwise. So they'll take a view, but equally so will the accountable officer and the commissioner too. We're approaching the end of this financial year now, 22-23. Commissioner's office will be preparing its annual report and accounts, its governance statement, which is effectively the section of the annual accounts that for the accountable officer to set out their view of how effective governance has been. My report this morning includes extracts from the 21-22 governance statement. The accountable officer themselves will want to update on their view of progress on the audit recommendations in this year's accounts. The auditor will form that view, and I'll report either through a section 22, but depending on progress, perhaps just through correspondence with the committee. So you'll have that clear audit judgment of progress, Deputy Convener.
Thank you. Moving on to paragraph 17. In respect of the directions that were issued by the Standards Commission for Scotland, do you have any information on how long they are likely to remain in place for?
I'm not sure I do. I'll maybe bring Pat in a second. I think ultimately a statutory direction, and the history to this was difficult in that this was part of the issue of the breakdown of relationships that existed between the Commissioner's Office previously and the Standards Commission. What we know, what we're reporting, is that the Commissioner's Office judgment is that they have complied with all of the requirements of that statutory direction. Up to 21-22, it remained in place. But in terms of progress, I'll turn to colleagues if we have any further detail.
Yes, the main directions are in place for another 2 years. I think there's three or four distinctive directions, but the encouraging thing is that the main direction, which is really to investigate every complaint, which is, as I say, is the key direction, that's only been put in place for the next 6 months before that will be looked at again. So I think that's encouraging news that it's such a short window for that one. But several of the other ones, I think, are there for 2 years.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to bring in Colin Beattie in, but just before I do that, can I go back to the question that Sharon Dowry was asking you was about the governance arrangements and the relationship between the SPCB and Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Public Life of Scotland office. And part of your reply, Pat, I think, was about the new whistleblowing arrangements. Richard mentioned the threshold and so on, and internal outlets for people inside the organisation who've got concerns. And I think that's right. But I think there were other warning signs, were there not, that didn't simply need to rely on staff working in the organisation to point out that there were some things not quite going as they ought to do. And I, you know, when I look at last year's Section 22 report, I think you documented that in 2016-17, 43% of complaints against councillors and board members were not pursued further. But by the time we get to 2020-21, 84% of the cases lodged were not pursued. So there were so it wasn't just a matter of those people who worked day in, day out, having some concerns about the culture. Presumably there ought to have been some external monitoring of quite a big change in the way that complaints were being processed. And again, it comes back to this root point, which is this is about public trust and confidence in this whole system.
Yeah, number of points can be maybe to cover in that. You're right. I think in my own response, I talked about, I suppose, the trying to strike the right balance. And I think that's seen in evidence of the correspondence that the parliamentary corporate body has had with the Finance Committee and also with your own committee about the overall accountability arrangements for independent commissioners, that the Parliament and its committees have a clearer opportunity to exercise oversight and accountability, but not impinge upon the independence. And you're quite right, some of those statistics suggest that those in themselves ought to have been alarm bells, warning signs that would have led to queries and challenges from the Parliament and the parliamentary corporate body. We welcome the progress and the intended wider, stronger arrangements to support that parliamentary oversight of commissioners. I think, as I said as well, inevitably this will be one of balance, that a commissioner is independent, is able to feel that they can exercise their statutory functions appropriately. But where there are evident signs, whatever suite of measures, whether it's performance indicators, the staff whistleblowing arrangements, all of that serve as appropriate checks and balance. But I agree with you, looking back, as I have done, to last year's report, they were clear signs of an organisation under stress.
Thank you. And we'll come on to the outstanding cases that are sitting in the Commissioner's office at the moment. But I'm going to bring Colin Beattie in. Colin.
Thank you, Mayor. General, I'd like to actually expand a little bit on what the Convener has been saying about governance and so on. I'm looking at Exhibit 1 in your report, which shows some reporting lines. The Ethical Standards Commissioner, according to this, reports in to two different bodies, depending on what the source of the complaints are, to the Standards Commission for Scotland, the Standard Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. What oversight do they have, actually, in terms of the Ethical Standards Commissioner?
Exhibit 1 does set out the relationship between the Ethical Standards Commissioner and its key stakeholders, both with... I'll come directly to your oversight question in a moment, Mr. Beattie, but maybe say that... I suppose the exhibit illustrates that there is a complexity here, both in terms of reporting lines from the work of the Commissioner, depending on the subject matter, MSPs, lobbyists, or public appointment process, through to the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee of the Parliament. If it relates to members of public boards or local authority councillors, it goes to the Standards Commission. Oversight and reporting didn't work effectively. I think that's one of the clear judgments that we can see from both last year's report And whilst welcoming the progress this year, you see that there is still an issue that requires careful consideration. You know, we welcome the fact that the presiding officer herself is taking an interest in this alongside the chief executive of the parliament to have that clear balance. And I'm continuing to use that word, if I may, Mr. Beattie, about the independence of the commissioners, that they're able to carry out their functions as intended, but there are sufficient checks and balances alongside the work of commissioners. I think from what I read of the correspondence is that some of these issues go wider than just those of the Commissioner for Ethical Standards. It's about a wider consideration of all of the independent commissioners that are appointed by the Parliament. And if I, reading carefully the official report that the Parliamentary Corporate Body and their evidence to the Finance and Public Administration Committee, that there are more commissioners that are potentially coming into the Parliament's arrangements. Therefore, there's a, you know, it's a really opportune moment here to just to say, well, that the Parliament itself is satisfied that they have that balance between their independence and their oversight. The split of that oversight, I think, is as set out, but you know that those arrangements have been tested. And you can, if I just to finish on that one last example that we set out in last year's report, that wasn't able to be resolved as it related to local authority members and public boards by the Standards Commission other than it issuing a statutory direction. That feels like a one end of a spectrum of interventions that a key stakeholder could make, that there ought to have been other opportunities for oversight, especially by the Parliament itself.
Do we understand what the Standards Commission and Standards Procedures and Public Appointments Committee, what they understand by oversight? Is it the same as what we think oversight is, or are they just passively receiving reports in from the Ethical Standards Commissioner as and when?
There's a limit to my understanding, and it's probably not appropriate for me to speak on behalf of the Standards Commission for Scotland or indeed the Standards Committee of the Parliament. The only thing I would probably add to that is that I don't think you could say that would be a passive recipient, certainly not the Standards Commission for Scotland. Can clearly, as we set out in last year's report and have updated today, those relationships broke down. And rather than being passive on it, the Standards Commission issued that statutory direction to safeguard its interests in its own statutory functions. It may be something, Mr. Beattie, that the committee may wish to explore further with those two organisations.
Still looking at that exhibit, if we're looking at the SPCB, and you have here Advisory Audit Board, can you describe what that is, what the Advisory Audit Board actually does?
Yes, the Advisory Audit Board of the Parliamentary Corporate Body is akin to an audit committee. So it will receive reports from the internal auditors, the external auditors, but its primary purpose is to advise the Principal Accountable Officer of the Clerk to the Scottish Parliament to support his approval and consideration of the annual report and accounts. So also, its business goes wider than that, but it will also consider risk management arrangements and, as I mentioned, audit reports. So I think the best description is it's the audit committee of the Parliamentary Corporate Body.
And you have here a dotted line from the Advisory Audit Board where you say members drawn from the SPCB's own Advisory Audit Board. So does that mean that the individuals who are appointed to do all the investigations and so on are also members of the Advisory Board?
No, I think there's a slight nuance to this, actually, and I'm going to bring Pat in a moment. I can say a bit more about some of the detail of this. So ultimately, the the re-established Audit Advisory Board of the Commissioner's Office, whilst sharing membership of that of the Parliamentary Corporate Body's own AAB, is not tasked with investigations. It's about the internal governance and running of the Commissioner's Office, rather than having a direct operational function to consider. If I've understood your question correctly, Mr. Beattie, about
these members are doing in the Ethical Standards Commissioner's Office.
Ultimately, you would describe them as non-executives. Non-executive members that the Parliament appoints to support the Principal Accountable Officer in respect of audit risk, internal audit matters. So it's not about the day-to-day running of the organisation, rather it's about effective governance. If I might, before passing on to Pat, can say a bit more about this. One of the fundamentals of last year's report was that the AAB wasn't operating. So effectively this was an organisation that had one of the core of good governance didn't have an audit committee to support the Commissioner and the Accountable Officer discharge their functions. It's welcome that that's back in place and operating as intended, but I think maybe just illustrates the scale of breakdown of governance that it's almost unheard of for a public body not to operate with an audit committee or advisory board. If I may, Pat can again add a bit more depth to that.
Yeah. So typically, Mr. Beattie, the advisory board would, for example, approve the internal audit plan, the areas of the internal audit function we're looking at, would review internal audit reports, external audit reports, assess whether they were fit for purpose, make observations, suggestions. That's the typical role, and the auditors would be, if you like, accountable to the advisory board members. But as the Auditor General mentioned, the key issue that was the root cause of a lot of these issues was the breakdown that the advisory board didn't sit under the previous Commissioner at Ethical Standards. And that was a major cause of the failure, I think. Just coming slightly back to, I had 6 years of audit appointments for all the commissioners within Scotland, and my feeling as I leave that appointment is it's a very distinctive role, the commissioner, and the advisory board has similarities to an audit committee, as the Auditor General mentioned, but in my experience it doesn't have the full power of an audit committee that you would see in other parts of the public sector. And I was struck when I took over the appointments of the commissioners, because of that independence dimension, I'd never quite experienced anything quite like it before, despite a wide public sector experience, because the commissioners were very keen to emphasise their independence to me. And that took several manifestations. So it's a very, very, because they're smaller bodies, but very high profile bodies and very different and distinctive bodies, that my feeling as I leave is that it possibly would be worth having an independent review of the governance model end to end between the commissioners and the Parliament corporate body, because of that distinctiveness, because of that difference that you don't see in other parts of the public sector.
Did the SPCB receive reports from the Advisory Audit Board? I mean, I understand that the Advisory Audit Board within the Ethical Standards Commissioner failed to meet and just didn't do its job, but presumably the Advisory Audit Board that's linked to the SPCB was still functioning, and SPCB was receiving reports. What kind of reports?
Pat, do you want to pick that up?
In the year that they weren't functioning, I would need to double check this, but I don't think the S there was obviously no formal reporting link between the Ethical Standards Advisory Board and the corporate body, and that was part of the issue, and that was one of the red flags for me in that year of audit. I can double check what exactly happened there, Mr. Beattie, but I don't think there was any reporting in that sense in that particular year.
What reporting would you expect?
Yeah, I think, given the fact that they share membership or ought to have shared membership, there ought to have been an escalation arrangement that a member sitting on the AAB of the Commissioner's office should have had the opportunity to highlight to the Parliamentary Corporate Body's own Audit Advisory Board that there were issues of concern. I think this goes back to the conversation with the convener, that actually for the Parliamentary Corporate Body to take its own view now about what checks, balances, oversight arrangement it wants from its commissioners, I think perhaps speaks to the wider point Pat is making, that these are unusual governance arrangements. Although I should say that the committee will be interested to know that this is the arrangement that the Scottish Government also has through its Audit and Assurance Committee. It too is advisory to support the Principal Accountable Officer, so not quite as you would recognise as a more traditional audit committee. But yes, there should be an escalation opportunity for the Commissioner's Audit Advisory Boards into the Parliamentary Corporate Bodies, OON, AAB, and beyond, if as necessary, Mr. Beattie.
Has that now been put in place?
So I think those are the arrangements that are being proposed, as well as the suggestion to the conveners group that there's wider oversight. We would need to just kind of explore further with the Parliament themselves that those are the precise requirements. But it does, you know, very clearly we can see that this matter has been taken seriously, and that governance is in a stronger position. I do have a slight caveat that we've not yet encountered an example where they've been tested to that extent. I think it is that the scenario and stress testing of that all parties are clear about roles and responsibilities.
Just got a couple of quick questions then for you. Both in your report and in your opening remarks, you talked about, and I quote from your report, the dual task of meeting core business demands alongside progressing the remaining auditor recommendations means that significant pressures on the Commissioner's office are likely to continue in the coming year. Can you maybe expand a little bit on some of these pressures and what action needs to be taken to address them?
So, yeah, happy to do that, actually. And I think it's all well and good for us to recognise that. I think what is also welcome that the Commissioner's office themselves are reporting that, and I mentioned the in-flight analogy a few minutes ago, that this has taken a lot from the organisation to recover to the position of where it's rebuilding its relationships. It is with external parties, with its staff as well, and also discharging its statutory functions as intended. It's got work to do, as we set out in Exhibit 2 about the scale of complaints that have been received, together with the reported backlog. I think our report sets out that there is a 9-month backlog for people to have an initial complaint assessed. The Commissioner's website is reporting some progress. They're now saying that it's now 8 months for an initial assessment. However, this does still contrast with a number of weeks wait, as was the case before the pandemic and organisational challenges that exist. Progress-wise, I think it is important to stress that the organisation has undertaken a strategic workforce review, and that led it to a conclusion that it was under-resourced and understaffed to discharge its functions. It needed to have an operating staff of around 20 people, and at that point it was identified that it was 7.4 whole-time equivalents short of that number. That formed the fundamentals of their budget submission to the Parliamentary Corporate Body. Now, since approved, by the Parliament. So what to do still, Mr. Beattie, to recruit to these new posts, to provide training and engagement with new colleagues, to deliver ongoing statutory work and at the same time claw back some of the backlog that has grown?
You've actually addressed to some extent the second question I was going to ask, but which was about staffing and capacity concerns that have been evident in terms of 2021-22. Are you satisfied that the workforce capacity has now been resolved?
I think that's as much a question for the Commissioner's Office themselves, that they've reached that judgment. Certainly that was the basis of their budget submission to the Parliamentary Corporate Body and the Parliament's consideration of it. They have grown by almost 50% in terms of staffing cohort. Clearly that's hugely significant. And quite at odds with what you would expect of budgetary constraint at the current time. So it's clearly it is their judgment that that was what was needed for them to operate effectively, to discharge their statutory functions and to make inroads into that backlog. From an auditor's perspective, we'll continue to monitor and assess that progress over the course of the year ahead.
Thank you, Mayor.
Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to invite Sharon Dowie to come back in with another question. Sharon. Right,
thank you. You mentioned in your reply there to Colin Beattie about the workforce planning exercise, and that revealed the Commissioner's Office would not be able to meet its statutory functions and address the recommendations made in your 2020-21 audit report. Emergency proposals for additional funding were submitted to the SPCB in May 2022 and were granted in October 2022. Which is quite a long time period for something that's described as emergency proposals. Do you have a view in that?
I'm not familiar with any particular reason why there was a gap between the proposals from the Commissioner's Office, the Parliament's consideration and approval. The only thing I can assume would be that it was deemed appropriate that sat in line with the Parliament's overall consideration of the Parliamentary Corporate Body's budget submission for the 23-24 year. So I think there's perhaps something of a two-stage element to the workforce component, Deputy Convener. I think as we set out in the report, they have recruited to vacancies in their staffing structures, so gone some way to part to address the full complement of staff that was needed. But the second element will be far more substantial. It may be that the Parliamentary Corporate Body is better placed to answer its consideration as to why it felt that it was better to wait for the annual budget setting process rather than an autumn budget review.
So that delay in confirming the funding, that would have an impact on them being able to action the recommendations in the report?
So I think it is fair to say that there's a correlation between those two things. So that the Commissioner's Office themselves have noted that the scale of challenge that they've been dealing with in the current year of delivering their statutory function whilst addressing audit recommendations. We would expect to see now that I would think it really will be into 23-24 as they recruit to the new staffing structure that we'll see more significant inroads into compliance and addressing the backlog.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think you mentioned Exhibit 2 in one of your answers there, and I know that Craig Hoy's got some questions in that area as well. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Bowles. Nice to see you again. Just want to get a sense of whether or not we're turning the corner on the backlog. Exhibit 1 on page 7 of the report provides information on the increases in complaints still open at the year end of 2021 and 21-22, and it shows an increase in respect of complaints still open that relate to local councils and boards of 122, and an increase of cases relating to MSPs of 22, so 22 are higher than the year before. Obviously, you reference that they're just closing the 22-23 figures, because those backlogs obviously relate to 31st of March 2022. Do you at this point in time have an impression as to whether or not the backlog is now falling?
Certainly that's what the Commissioner's Office is reporting on its own website. So saying that the backlog, as we report, was 9 months, they're now advising the public that it's fallen to 8 months. So clearly that is progress. There's still a way to go, Mr. Hoy, to address the, I think the point I mentioned in my introductory remarks, that actually whilst a backlog of that extent remains, it risks challenging the trust and confidence in the process of those that are making complaints and also those that are subject to a complaint. So small signs of progress. Clearly what we all want to see is that investment that the parliamentary corporate body has made in the organisation into a growing staffing complement will address that backlog quicker over the course of 2023.
Fine. Just perhaps you've talked quite extensively about staffing and restrictions and budgets, but I just wanted to reflect on paragraph 22 of the report, which states that all vacancies bar one have now been filled. However, when discussing the complaints backlog, paragraph 25 states that additional recruitment will help, but that it will take time for this to be completed. Does this mean that further additional posts have been created? And if so, can you say how many and whether or not the recruitment exercise is presently underway for those?
Yes, so there's two separate things. One is paragraph 22 refers to the previously agreed staffing structure and that vacancies which had arisen, which was one of the contributory factors to the issues in the organisation. All those posts had been the pre-existing structure have now been filled. The parliamentary corporate body in the Parliament in the emergency budget proposal that the Deputy Convener referred to have agreed to increase the staffing cohort of the Commissioner's Office by 7.4 additional whole-time equivalents. So a real significant growth in the organisation, and that is the recruitment that's currently underway to fill for those vacancies.
Obviously, for the public and also for elected members and board members to have confidence in the system, it's important that we do see sustained improvements in performance. Your report states that the Commissioner's Office is planning to introduce performance indicators to track complaints handling and that this will be introduced by March of this year. Can you tell us if this work is going according to plan and if the deadline of March 23 will be met?
Yeah, I'll ask Pat to pick that up if he has more detail on it.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah, pleased to confirm, Mr. Hoy, that these KPIs are part of the new investigations manual, which will be finalised in this month, which has been subject to extensive consultation. And there's clear KPIs in there for in terms of stage one assessment, stage two assessments, with targets set at each stage of the investigation process. So that will be implemented from this month.
So just a final question, and this is again a bit of a kind of crystal ball projection, Mr. Ball, but in relation to an acceptable level of backlog, what would that be comparable with similar institutions?
So I think I would probably need to take away and come back to the committee in writing what the Commissioner for Ethical Standards in Scotland's backlog relates to other parts of the UK and wider jurisdictions. I'm happy to do that, Mr. Hoy. But in terms of its own performance, I think I mentioned already this morning that before the organisational issues that were documented last year and updated on today, it was a number of weeks of backlog as opposed to 8 to 9 months that we're currently operating. So in today's report, we think there is the foundation for progress to re-establish the Commissioner's Office. It's done well to address the audit recommendations. We expect to see that the investment that the parliamentary corporate body has made in additional staff to make inroads into that backlog quickly over the course of this year.
Yep, thank you very much. Thanks, Kevin.
Thank you very much. There are just a couple of areas I wanted to cover before we close, and one was to go back to that Exhibit 2 table, which tells us about the rate of complaint. I mean, I have to say that one of the things that struck me was that there are 1,227 elected councillors in Scotland, and that's not including board members that are added to that category as well, who are facing 146 complaints. There are 129 MSPs who are facing 760 complaints. Why is there that differential?
I would only be speculating, Convener, as to the rationale for what draws a member of the public to raise a complaint about a member of the Scottish Parliament as opposed to a local authority elected member or parliament board. I assume that the profile and reach of members of the Scottish Parliament is such that it brings more attention as opposed to that of elected members and members of public boards. My speculation is maybe not that helpful, Convener.
Yes, I understand as an auditor you don't want to speculate, and we're very flattered by what you've just told us about our profile. But I think the serious point is the one which I made earlier on, which was when the organisation appeared to be in some kind of crisis, one of the measures of that was the extent to which cases were not pursued, and I cited the example of complaints against councillors, 84%. Were not pursued. Do you have any up-to-date figures about the number of cases that are not being pursued?
So those KPIs are set out in the Commissioner's Office report, and Pat may have a bit more detail to hand. I'll turn to him in a second. The only point I would just, which is aligned to that, Convener, is that perhaps worth reiterating, I think came up in evidence last year, is that the Commissioner sought legal advice just to test whether cases that had previously been adjudicated on could be revisited, and the advice was that no, they couldn't understand statute. So there, it matters that the process is right going forward, and to re-emphasise that trust and confidence of the public in the totality of the process. If we have that, if Pat has that detail, he can share it with you, Convener. If not, we can again come back to you in writing.
Yeah, we can come back with the specifics, but my understanding is that the figure is now more in line with what you would expect from historical percentages. There has been a change back to the norm.
Okay, thanks. That's helpful. I mean, you mentioned the situation, which I certainly raised last year, and I think other members of the committee raised as well, which was a concern that we've got that I think is referred to in the audit report as functus officio, which is the Latin legal term, which means people who had cases that were discarded, maybe as part of that 84%, don't have a right to resurrect those claims. Those claims, complaints are dead. And I think that does raise a wider question, doesn't it, about public confidence in the system and whether or not those people had justice served or not. I mean, I wonder whether you've got a comment about that.
Convener, I mean, on receipt of Pat's audit report last year, I mean, the judgment I made to raise a Section 22 report last year was primarily on that basis, so that you know, the Parliament and the public can have awareness and look to restore trust and confidence in this important function on behalf of the people of Scotland. That this was it exists for a reason. It wasn't operating effectively. I think there is, with some regret, and perhaps that the Commissioner's Office isn't able to revisit those cases, because undoubtedly it will take a lot for a member of the public to raise a concern, whether it's about a member of a public board, a councillor, an MSP, or indeed a lobbyist for that matter, and that them unable to have confidence that their complaint either was or wasn't one of the ones that was deemed to be handled properly, no doubt will require effective communication from the Commissioner's Office going forward, just so that they can reassure the public that arrangements are now operating as intended.
Thank you. And those people may indeed seek their own legal advice on that interpretation. One of the other things in this area that rang a bit of an alarm bell with me was the management update on the recommendations around this whole area. which included the this excerpt. We took our own legal advice and concluded that we could not reopen investigations on the basis of the legal principle functus officio. We also concluded that there would be no value in conducting a lessons learned process. Why was that conclusion arrived at?
Can I, do you have a page reference I can draw on?
Yeah, I'm looking at the action plan.
Yeah.
3.4.
Thank you. Yeah, I see that. Certainly, the legal advice is as noted. Pat may want to say a bit more about the auditor's judgment in respect of that. My take on it is effectively that the organisation has changed so fundamentally since its period of challenge. They have a new commissioner, they have a new acting accountable officer, they have re-established governance arrangements that weren't in place. I can go on, convener, in terms of new business plans, strategic plans. So there is a very clear direction of travel for the organisation in terms of complying with its statutory functions and addressing the issues at hand. I think overall, together with rebuilding relationships and the oversight point that we've talked about this morning in terms of the parliamentary corporate body, many of the components of lessons learned are actually happening. So even if management judgment is that an exercise labelled as such is not necessary, I think it's clear to see that all the evidence before the committee reflects, you know, events that took place and response. So, as I say, whilst not being called that, I think it's clear to see that in the round is what's happening. That's my take on it. I'll pass to Pat. He might have more.
Yeah, I agree totally, Auditor General. I mean, we made that recommendation at the time. I think it was on lessons learned, and that was before we really fully understood the degree of change within the organisation with a new commissioner. So I'm satisfied in terms of how they have taken on board the recommendations and the progress been made, that, as the Auditor General has said, effectively the lessons have been learned.
Thank you. Well, again, one of the issues which arose last year was a separation of the Commissioner from the position of Accountable Officer. Can I just clear up what the current status is?
Yes, yeah, so those arrangements have continued, and the committee, I'm sure, will know that a permanent Commissioner was appointed in January, Ian Bruce, who had been acting as the Commissioner. The Accountable Officer had been acting as the... Pat may help me. Actually, I've forgotten the previous job holder's title, but one of the senior officers,
yeah,
in the Commissioner's office. In terms of forward arrangements, I think it's my understanding that they're continuing to remain separate, but again, I'll check in with colleagues if they have any... contrary.
That's my understanding. Yeah.
Can I ask Pat Kenny, you've shared with us your experience of dealing with commissioners' offices over a long number of years. Is that a usual arrangement, that there is a split between the commissioner and the accountable officer role?
That is, it's not the norm. And I think it was applied in this case, given the obviously the very specific issues that were relevant to this organisation. But I think it's fair to say that it's not the norm. But I think that would be something that it possibly might be worth a reconsideration of that again in terms of what would happen in other commissioners. Because I can definitely see the argument for it being the same individual. Yeah.
Auditor General, do you have a view on that?
I think there's pros and cons, convener, actually, and you know that even in outside of the realms of commissioners, there are one or two other examples in Scottish public bodies where there is that separation. For example, in the Registers of Scotland, the keeper of the registers, although effectively as the chief executive, isn't the accountable officer by virtue of statute, in terms of they themselves are part of the Scottish administration. So there's that, just managing what would be perceptions of conflict of interest. So there are isolated examples where the most senior official isn't the accountable officer. In this example, I don't think it's an unhelpful consequence that they've reached to, particularly given some of the statute with their statutory functions, to have that separation. I think my I'm here to offer advice is that one that would be kept under review as to whether that the new model is operating as intended.
Thank you. I mean, I think maybe if anyone was to take up Pat Kenny's recommendation of an end-to-end review, that might be something that would be worth considering. And I think, I mean, from our point of view as a committee, it might be useful if we're able to get data on the accountable officer / commissioner role in the different commissions which are accountable to the Parliament. I think that would be useful for us to have sight of that, because of course the accountable officer is a position which is in the Scottish Public Finance Manual and is a designated position, and invariably I think is the person who is the most senior official in the organisation.
Yes, Convener, and of course they are personally accountable for the effective operation of the organisation and effective discharge of public funds to that organisation. We'd be very happy to work with the committee to kind of share further details on the commissioner's arrangements and indeed to engage further with the parliamentary corporate body on its intentions.
Thank you. The very final question I've got relates to something which Pat Kenny mentioned much earlier on in the session, because we were concerned a little bit about medium-term financial planning arrangements. And again, just picking up on the action plan report, we were struck by the expression in there where we were told it was at that point outstanding. But in the views of the management, this is considered a low priority, to which I think our question was, by who? Because medium-term financial planning, it seems to us, is pretty important in ensuring the sustainability of an organisation like a commissioner's office.
Can I say a word about that first, Convener, and I'll bring Pat in? Yes, there is, and I think in our own Section 22 report, we've noted that the need for a medium-term financial plan to feature prominently as part of the Commissioner's Office actions in the year ahead. We're not querying its financial sustainability in the short term, but it matters, as you would expect to hear from us, for all public bodies to have a medium-term financial plan to explore scenarios about how it will resolve them and that it's appropriately connected to their workforce and wider business planning arrangements. I think I'm right, but Pat can certainly correct me, that the low priority, I think that's the audit view that in terms of the prioritisation of recommendations. Pat can come in on that and say as much as he wishes.
Yeah, I think they are making progress, Chair, and I think they are looking for templates from other similar types of organisations and other parts of the public sector in terms of developing a medium-term financial plan. I do have, as I said, I've got 6 years' experience of commissioners' offices, and to be frank, there's often not a great deal of enthusiasm for medium-term financial planning. Typically, you would get the response, "Oh, we only get a one-year budget settlement, so what is the point of this?" And I've tried to, obviously to emphasise that I think it's very important in terms of governance that they engage in creating that medium-term financial plan. But you do find across the public sector and smaller organisations where they have a limited financial planning horizon that it's sometimes difficult to convince them of the merits of a medium-term financial plan. But that's the continuing role that we as auditors have to undertake to make sure that they get over the line in terms of completing that medium-term financial plan.
Thank you. And I think it's right that we'll leave the last word to you, Pat Kenny, because I think it's felt a little bit like you've shared with us the candour of an exit interview with your honest assessment of what's going on out there. I've certainly found that very, very useful. But can I thank the Auditor General, Richard Robinson, and Pat Kenny for your evidence this morning? We have found it very useful, and we will consider as a committee what our next steps are. So thank you for your contributions this morning, and I'm now going to close the public part of this morning's meeting.